of the metabolic syndrome. So this is the brief content of the presentation, background, different techniques to assess the pharmacological outcome, then experimental approaches to study the metabolic syndrome, then research opportunities, and if time permits, I will cover some relevant experimental data. So this is the herbal drug discovery. This is the conventional protocol. Here, right from this, we start with the selection of the plant material. So it is important to ascertain the authenticity of the plant material, which part of the plant you are using, stem, bark, leaf, and its taxonomical, ethnobotanical, and phytochemical authenticity by the apex body is also important, like Botanical Survey of India or Agarkar Research Institution. Then it goes to the extraction. There are various kind of extraction, water extraction, solvent extraction like alcohol or petroleum ether, based on the kind of compound you are targeting. So then here we need to ascertain the pharmacological activity, and then it goes to the fractionation. For fractionation of the molecule, one can use the different separation, that is called chromatographic analysis, technique like column chromatographic, conventional column chromatography, or then preparative HPTLC or preparative HPLC to the fractionate the active constituent, followed by isolation and characterization of the active constituent responsible for the bioactivity or pharmacological activity. And then it goes to the formulation, followed by clinical trial, regulatory approval, and marketing of the product. So pharmacology plays a key role in the entire process, right from the plant material to the market approval and post-market analysis also. Now this is the drug discovery, conventional drug discovery. Earlier we seen the herbal drug discovery. This is the conventional drug discovery. So drug discovery is divided into the actually five parts. First part is in vitro drug discovery, then preclinical. Preclinical include in silico and in vivo. Then clinical. Clinical divided is again divided in three phases: phase one, phase two, phase three. Then regulatory approval, followed by marketing, that is FDA monitoring, in fifth phase. So in vitro, first stage is in vitro, where in vitro models are, as we all know, these are reductionist model. Not all drugs we can assess using in vivo. So here you can reduce the, your number of molecule, your number of activities, and you can go in depth in vitro model. These are homogeneous, inexpensive. You can say in vitro assays are very expensive, but if you look at the kind of workload we can take up, the time required to complete the assays, I would say in vitro assays are very inexpensive. Then homogeneous, they are completely controlled, high throughput analysis can be done, cell and organ level action can be studied. Then these can be made humanized. Then these are personalized and customized. Then coming to the stage two, that is preclinical, which include in silico and in vivo. In silico, like in silico drug discovery is nowadays one of the essential requirement of the drug discovery, because these are very simple, inexpensive. Here also we can do high throughput analysis, and these are customized. These are, we can study the receptor level, receptor binding assay, like docking and all. Then in vivo, these are very expensive, time consuming, lot of ethical considerations are involved in this nowadays, and less controlled and limited quantification is available. Then phase three is clinical. This is again divided into phase three phases, that is phase one, phase two, and phase three. Now you are aware that COVID vaccine is under phase three, and most of you are quite aware of the what are the stages of the clinical studies. Followed by fourth stage is regulatory approval, and then market analysis. After, once the product is approved by FDA, FDA monitors all sorts of the drug effect of drug, its safety, efficacy, once product is in the market. So now we will see the what is the metabolic syndrome. So first definition, we will see the WHO definition, World Health Organization definition. its main focus is diabetes, impaired fasting glucose, impaired glucose tolerance or insulin resistance. And at least two of the following conditions should be met. That is waist to hip ratio more than 0.9 in men and 0.85 in women. Then TG more than or equal to 1.7 millimoles per liter or HDL less than 0.9 millimoles per liter in men. And then blood pressure more than or equal to 140:90 mm of HgA. Urinary albumin excretion rate more than 20 mg per minute or albumin to creatinine ratio more than or equal to 30 mg per gram. Now coming to the second definition, these are the two most commonly used definition for the metabolic syndrome. Second definition is International Diabetes Federation, that is IDF definition, which mainly considers the obesity, central obesity. The TG level is more than equal to 150 mg per dl, HDL 140 mg per dl in men and 50 in women. Then blood pressure more than or equal to 130 by 85 mm of HG, and fasting blood glucose more than or equal to 100 mg per dl. So these are, there are various ways and means, and these criteria is changing as per the ethnicity, various region and men to women. Cardiovascular diseases play a key role. Cardiovascular death rate globally, global cardiac death is very abundant, and 17.7 million deaths are reported in recently by Lancet journal at global level. If you look at the higher income countries, the cancer is a leading cause, and in case of middle income countries and low income countries group, the cardiovascular disease is the leading cause of the death. And this is one of the major comorbidity of the metabolic syndrome. Metabolic syndrome is also associated with non-alcoholic fatty liver diseases, kidney function and pancreatic dysfunction. Lifestyle and diet modulate the metabolic syndrome, and this induces the pathophysiological changes throughout the body. Hence it is important to study the progression and treatment strategies for the metabolic syndrome. So we have a lot of opportunities to see the pharmacological, as of now there is no pharmacological remedies available to treat this metabolic syndrome. In this cardiovascular disorder, there are various disease conditions like atherosclerosis, which its prevalence is 30% and annual mortality rate is 5-6%. If you consider myocardial infarction, the annual mortality rate is 34-42%. In case of arrhythmia, it is 15%. In cardiomyopathy, contributes 6-8%. So I will give an example why preclinical pharmacology is important in this drug discovery. You are aware of rofecoxib. This drug was originally designed to treat the patient related to osteoarthritis, and approved by FDA in 1919 was, and it was found that it was linked over 27,000 cardiovascular death and myocardial infarction. So it was withdrawn from the market in 2004 and later relicensed for more specific indication. In the preliminary clinical investigation, the drug showed efficacy in its target treatment, and adverse events were not very significant. But after 4 years of long-term clinical studies, it was observed that it gives two-fold heart attack and stroke as compared to the control group. So this product was withdrawn from the market, and here the pharmacology plays a key role. If you can assess the toxicity, during our preclinical study, there will be less attrition, because late stage attritions are very frequent in drug discovery, and 70% of the human toxicity can be approximated in the preclinical stage itself. So we need to also look into the novel approaches which are required to make the drug discovery more affordable, because it takes almost 12 years and more than $2 billion for a single molecule to come into the market. Now we will see the assessment of outcome of metabolic syndrome using preclinical studies. So first, these are the biochemical estimation that we need to consider in metabolic syndrome. That is everyone might be aware. I am just enlisting this list: diabetic HbA1c, kidney function test, liver function test, OGTT, insulin resistant, hematology, bun, AST, ALT, CKMB, lipid profile, then body weight, water intake, food consumption, endogenous marker, ELISA marker, like TNF-alpha, IL-6, there are various protein markers that we can consider for clinical biochemistry of the metabolic syndrome. Then this is the typical power lab setup. Here we can study the effect of drug using invasive blood pressure measurement. So here animal is anesthetized using urethane. We can do the cannulation of the right carotid artery for insertion of cannula, and jugular vein also can also be cannulated to study the intravenous effect of the drug. Then P cannula filled with heparin is connected to the pressure transducer, and signal is amplified by means of bioamplifier for the data acquisition. At the same time, these are the ECG leads, negative, positive and neutral electrodes to study the ECG profiling. So this is the ECG. Here we can study the heart rate, beats per minute, QRS interval, QTC interval, corrected QT interval and ST interval in the animal model. And these are its indication where we can actually measure these intervals. So this is again in the Meniere catheter to study the left ventricular function. So instead of cannula, you can insert this Meniere catheter. This Meniere catheter contains a sensor at its tips, distal end at the tip. This tip amplifies the signal, and data acquisition can be done with respect to the various parameters like systolic blood pressure, diastolic blood pressure, mean arterial blood pressure, left ventricular systolic pressure, left ventricular developed pressure, max dt by dt, mean dp by dt, and the actual effect in left ventricle can be studied using this Meniere catheter. There are two kind of even pressure volume and pressure, both Meniere catheters are available to study the effect of drug. Then during the course of the animal model, we can record the intermittent blood pressure recording using this non-invasive blood pressure measurement. So these are restainers, different kind of restainers are available for rat, mice, guinea pig, and animal has to train to study this using these restainers, and systolic blood pressure can be recorded using this non-invasive blood pressure. And these are the normal values in different species: body weight, heart rate, and blood pressure in mouse, rat, and guinea pig, and rabbit. Now coming to the Langendorf. Langendorf is a very useful equipment to study the working rat heart model. So this is the junction block. Here the perfused rat heart. This is the perfused rat heart that is kept, and through this we can pass the Krebs-Henslet buffer solution. pH is 7.4. At 37, temperature can be maintained, regulated at 37. So this is a actual real representation of the clinical correlation. In this, we can study various kinds of studies using this Langendorf preparation, because here we can stop the perfusion for the 30 minutes, which is called as global ischemia, followed by reperfusion for 60 to 120 minutes. And this reperfusion studies, that is global ischemia, can be studied, which induces the ischemia in the heart, an effect of drug, against this myocardial ischemia can be studied, and all data that I explained in earlier slides, like this parameter, left ventricular developed pressure, end diastolic pressure, ECG, left ventricular developed pressure, because here also we can insert the inner catheter into the left ventricle, and all these parameters can also be recorded. So isolated right heart organ perfusion, ischemia refurbishment study, toxicity study, pharmacological efficacy with regard to the cardiovascular effect can be studied. Then myocardial function, hypertrophy, infarction, cardiac myopathic model can be studied. Then these are the metabolic cages. This provides an uncontaminated, reliable sample for accurate metabolic monitoring. So this separates the fecus and urine into the tubes inside the cages, and various kind of rat species like mice, rat, and other rodents are available. These are autoclavable, so there is no chance of contamination of fecus and urine within these metabolic cages, and we can study the metabolite if the product your drug is leading to the any metabolite. That metabolite can be also estimated using chromatographic techniques from this after extraction from the urine or fecus. Then coming to the DEXA, this is dual energy X-ray absorptiometry. This used the body composition analysis. As we all know, metabolic syndrome is primarily attributed to the central obesity. So this visceral adiposity index is a key indicator of the fat function associated with the metabolic syndrome. This visceral adiposity index has been proposed to be a useful tool for early detection of a condition of metabolic risk, cardiometabolic risk, before it develops into the overt metabolic syndrome. And this can be calculated using this formula, and we can use the DEXA scan to know this visceral adiposity index, and we can assess the effect of drug on this. So this is the actual rat, and under DEXA it looked like this. So complete analysis DEXA scan can be carried out in the live animal. Then entire mouse imaging is also a very important technique, where it gives the accurate measurement of bone and tissue for small animals. It is used for mainly for mice. Then measurement of bone, fat, and lean tissue, which gives the clear correlation with the total their ASHT or chemical extraction rate. It is a fast image analysis camera, and best advantage is a live animal imaging. You need to just the anesthetize the animal using isoflurane gas, and you can do the entire image and mouse imaging using this image analyzer. Then this is the most recent technique, that is multi-scale X-ray phase contrast tomography. So here you can look, this is the rat heart. Then we need to do the extraction. This is sample preparation, and this is kept in this tomography system. This is the sample stage. So the light is passed, this light source, this is the source, and here there are two microscopes, high resolution and low resolution microscope. This is the whole heart at low resolution, this is high resolution. So the low heart resolution gives the overall geometry and remodeling analysis. Then detailed morphological studies can be done using this whole heart low resolution microscope, and cell aggregation, orientation, tracking, complete tracking of the heart can be done. In case of high resolution microscope, actual quantification of collagen can be done. Then vasculature properties can be studied. And again, low resolution, here cell aggregation, orientation, and tracking is also possible. So this gives the complete real-time picture of the heart, effect of the heart, effect of the metabolic syndrome on heart, effect of the drug, your drug on the heart. The complete image analysis can be done using this multi-scale X-ray phase contrast tomographic system. Now coming to the different strains, to assess the histopathological changes. This is the most common use at hemoxylin and eosin stain. This is the very general stain, and nuclear chromatin is stained in blue to purple. Then cytoplasm, collagen, keratin, and erythrocyte, these are stained in pink. And necrosis, pecknosis, and inflammation, these are can be detected using H&E staining. Then second one is for collagen deposition, picrocyrus and red staining is commonly used, specifically used for collagen deposition in cardiovascular disorder. So here you can see that this is collagen deposition, and here this is a cardiomyocytes that can be detected using this picrocyrus red staining. Even for this collagen, mesenchymal is also commonly used in. This is the fibrotic area. This is in blue color. Muscle and collagen fiber and erythrocyte can be stained. Then this is second staining, Van Giessen staining, where nuclei are stained in black, collagen are stained in red, cytoplasm, keratin, erythrocyte, these are stained in yellow. So this basically gives the these are the stains which are used to assess the various markers at histopathological level in metabolic syndrome animal model. Then Goldner trichome staining. Here nuclei are stained in red, collagen in blue, cytoplasm in various shades like red, pink, and orange, cartilage matrix in blue color. Then this is the TTC staining. TTC staining is gives the basically infarcted area. This infarcted, as I explained in in Langendorf experiment, where global ischemia is responsible for the infarction. So this is a typical stain where when you are dipping the heart in this stain, the infarcted area is discolored and live area is red. So this is the control letter where most of the area is red, and this is the global ischemia induced animal. So here you can see a lot of area is infected, and this area can be measured using various techniques, software technique, and this area can be measured also. Now this is the zebrafish model. This is a very cost effective model, and nowadays is being used by many scientists across the globe. This is the typical diagram of the zebrafish, and these are the real zebrafish animals. So this is the facility, zebrafish facility. It is found in sweet and brackish water. These are very small, 2 to 4 centimeter only, and allows weekly production of 300 eggs per breeding pair. Per bear, breeding pair gives 300 eggs. The results are very reproducible, and in terms of activity point of view also. And each female generates about 200 eggs. Basically, this zebrafish animal model is cost effective if you have the facility, because creating the facility is very costly. But once you have the facility, a number of animal and number of molecule under sterilization is not much difficult. So application of this zebrafish model, these are very small size. Rapid embryonic development, short generation type, then fertilization is external, optical transparency, you can actually see the actual effect using your open eyes. So husbandry cost is very less, full sequence, genome sequence analysis can be done, then high genetic homology with the human, complete clinical correlation is there. And then transgenic models are also available. High throughput screening for drug screening can be done, and drug can be given in direct administration of the drug can be given to the embryos. And this is the zebrafish ECG analysis. So this is the normal, and this is the disease induced. Then application of the zebrafish in heart regeneration, carcinogenesis, toxicology, stem cell, genome-wide association studies, and pharmacological screening of and different high throughput screening, intracardiac, intraperitoneal, all sorts of studies, pharmacological investigation using these general fish models can be performed. And these are the different molecules which are in the market. They have used zebra fish model to study the effect of drug, the toxicity and efficacy. Then some in vitro model tissue engineering approaches, primary cell culture. Primary cell culture is the direct harvest from the mother tissue, and it retains the similarity with respect to the in vivo phenotyping. But these are very limited expansion capacity and very short lifespan, but it gives the clear idea because the phenotype type is very much similar to its parents. So, but right now commercially available primary cell cultures are available to address this issue. Then stem cell, this is a very well technique, and recent in many of the disorders the stem cell technique is used because this is an undifferentiated cell with ability of cell renewal and differentiation into several type of specialized cell. So replacing of lost tissue and curing devastating diseases, stem cell is the most common, most widely used techniques. Then mesenchymal stem cell, this is also called therapy. These are the different products which came through this stem cell and mesenchymal techniques which are in the market. So this is the overall cardiovascular drug discovery studies. This can be done in phase 1, phase 2, phase 3, phase 4. So this is the translational approach, and this is the standard approaches to study the cardiovascular outcome of the drug. And these are the presently gene therapy, then replacement, wherein replacement of cardiovascular disease causing genes is being studied right now. Then diagnostic marker development is a new area where lot of scientists are involved, because development of a novel marker, a specific marker for particular comorbidities plays its key role. Then various kinds of omics technologies, that is metabolomics, genomics, nutritional effect of the drug development are being studied in recent times. So research approach is lifestyle modification remains the mainstay in the treatment of the metabolic syndrome. Even if you can reduce the 10% of the body weight, which rewards the appreciation in the reduction of blood pressure, favorable lipid profile, and improved glucose insulin homeostasis. Unfortunately, till date, no pharmacological therapy has been found to address all these components of the metabolic syndrome. So we have a lot of scope to work under metabolic syndrome. A drug like metformin or ACE inhibitor and statin are directed towards the individual component of the metabolic syndrome. But metabolic syndrome in totality is not yet under not studied or not treated or not preventable by using single pharmacological approach. So now we have very limited time, and I will quickly go to some experimental data. So here we have used flaxseed and omega-3 fatty acid, the combination therapy for the and this animal model of metabolic syndrome, or specifically cardiovascular model. So this is the flaxseed belonging to family Linum usitacissimum. In Marathi it is called as Zavas, Hindi mein se alsi kehte hai. It constitutes of mainly flax oil, which contains omega-3 fatty acid, dietary fiber, lignan, that is sequoia-solarisin, diglucoside, 28% protein, very low carbohydrate, and some amino acid and vitamins are present in this. Just a single slide for introduction of fatty acid. There are different kind of fatty acids: saturated fatty acid, monounsaturated fatty acid, polyunsaturated fatty acid. This is the fatty acid structure, and this is the alpha. This is the alpha end, and this is the omega end. And this omega third position, that is the omega 3 fatty acid, which is in linseed or in flaxseed, alpha linoleic acid is present, and this is the most important essential fatty acid. Is important in place a key role in metabolic syndrome. So just a single slide for the pharmacological importance of the omega-3 fatty acid. Earlier in prehistoric era, we used to get a lot of omega-3 fatty acid in our routine diet, but due to present dietary lifestyle, the omega-3 fatty acid is not present in our present diet. So omega 6 to omega 3 ratio, which in prehistorically it was 1:1, now this ratio is changed to 30:1, and which is mainly responsible for the metabolic syndrome. So this omega 3 fatty acid is important for diabetes, renal disease, mental disorder, arthritis, heart, and many other diseases. So this is the cultivated flaxseed farm in Vidarbha district, Vidarbha area of Maharashtra state. This is a flower, and these are the two different kind of flaxseeds. This is a brown flaxseed, and this is the Canadian variety. Yellow flaxseed is available. So brief objectives to preparation of hydroalcoholic extract of this flaxseed. Then anti-hyperlipidemic is in triatol induced animal model. Then isoprenaline and doxorubicin induced animal model, then Langendorf of heart preparation, and isolation of the molecule, characterization of the molecule, followed by confirmation of the anti-hyperlipidemic activity in the isolated molecule. So the quantification by HPTLC, here 40 mg per gram of SDG was observed in the hydroalcoholic extract. Similarly, that was confirmed in HPLC also. So both HPTLC and HPLC techniques were used. Then this is the general phytochemical analysis. So it was observed that carbohydrates were present, alkaloid and flavonoid, and saponins and other compounds were absent in this extract. Then triatol induced animal model. This is a well-known model. So here we observed that there was significant reduction at 500 mg per kg in flax lignin concentrate, and flax lignin concentrate alone in combination with omega-3 fatty acid was responsible for the reduction of the lipid profile with respect to various parameters such as cholesterol, triglyceride, HDL and LDL cholesterol. So FLC was dose dependent reduced, TC, TG, VLDL, then HDL cholesterol was also improved. Then isoprenaline induced animal model. Isoprenaline induced animal model. Here, the key cardiac marker like CKMB, LDH, and AST were significantly increased in ISO alone, and which was reduced significantly in all the treatment group, and more significant reduction was observed in case of flax lignin concentrate alone and in combination group. And this is the systolic blood pressure, diastolic blood pressure, and here there was not much significant difference because this was the acute model. Only heart rate was significantly increased in ISO alone, and there was not much effect on of therapy was observed. In case of histopathological analysis, the necrosis and pyknosis was significantly reduced, and it was almost comparable to that of control group only in case of combination of flax lignin concentrate alone in combination with omega-3 fatty acid, indicating the protective effect of the combination therapy than that of the FLC alone and omega-3 fatty acid alone group. Then similarly, in case of doxorubicin induced toxicity, this was 7-week model. Weekly, we gave doxorubicin 4 mg per kg intraperitoneally on 7th, 14th, and 21st 28 days, and pre-treatment was given for the 7 weeks, and at the end of study period we estimated different endogenous markers such as TNF alpha, GSH, MDA and sodium, and there was significant increase as compared to the dox alone group in case of FLC alone and in combination with omega-3 fatty acid, indicating the protective effect of the combination therapy. And then we carried out the histopathological analysis, which revealed the nuclear picnosis, cytoplasmic eosinophilia and inflammation was reduced to by the pre-treatment of FLC and omega-3 fatty alone. And then we also performed the transmission electron microscopy to confirm this result, which were confirmed by using TEM studies also. And omega-3 fatty acid in combination with flaxseed concentrate showed the protective effect at histopathological level. So in conclusion, TNF-alpha level, where TNF-alpha and MDA were reduced, ST-QT interval and blood pressure was neutralized, SOD and GSH were increased, and mortality due to dox treatment was significantly reduced in combination therapy. Then this is the Langendorf experiment, wherein 30-minute global ischemia followed by 120 minutes reperfusion model was used, and this is the TTC stain. So here you can see a lot of area is discolored, indicating the induction of the ischemia. In the global ischemia treated group, and which was reduced to the normal as that of the control group animal in case of the FLC alone in combination with omega-3 fatty acid, indicating the protective effect against the myocardial ischemia in Langendorf heart preparation. Then these are again MDA and GSH, which were significantly improved in flax lignan 500 mg per kg and treatment group. And again, histopathology of the heart showed the protective effect of the combination therapy than that of the alone therapy. Then we carried out the isolation of the active constituent in hydroalcoholic extract of the flax lignan concentrate using CFRX LS20 column. So this is a chromatographic column chromatography setup. So this here we loaded the drug and it was passed to the column, and we carried out the fractionation isolation of the molecule, and there we used 1D and 2D spectral analysis, various NOSI spectrum, COSI spectrum, NMR, MAS, IR, C13 spectrum for structural elucidation of the molecule. And after 1D and 2D spectral data, this was the structure assigned, and name of the isolated molecule was secoisolariceracinol diglucoside, and its melting point was 120 degrees Celsius. And this isolated molecule was again studied for its anti-hyperlipidemic activity, and it was found that after various dose differentiation, SDG isolated molecule showed 20 mg per kg was responsible for improving the HDL cholesterol level non-significantly, and significant reduction in total cholesterol, TG and VLDL at 20 mg per kg. So from 500 mg per kg FLC, we reduced down to 20 mg per kg in isolated molecule. So this is the overall conclusion, right from the cultivation from the farm, then processing of linseed for oil extraction, then lignan extraction by solvent-solvent extraction, then HPTLC, isolation, then column chromatography, spectral analysis, then characterization of the molecule, pharmacological efficacy, and proving the mechanism in animal model. And these are the publication from my this work, almost close to 10 publication we published on this topic. Thank you. Any question, please let me know. I hope I'm in time.
Thank you, doctor. I would be happy to handle and put across questions. if there are any questions from the audience to Dr. Anand. Let me check the chat box. Is there any question from the audience? Okay, so there are no questions from audience. Thank you, Dr. Anand, for giving a
deep
into metabolic syndromes. You have discussed so many parameters in detail and even given experimental data regarding various research work. Now, for proposing vote of thanks, I call upon my colleague, Mr. Yunus Ansari. Over to you, Yunus.
Thank you, sir. Thank you so much. I would like to, on the behalf of SNJB family, I would like to...
You are not audible.
Sir, I'm not audible. Hello? Am I audible, sir? Am I audible?
Yeah.
Okay. So, sir, on the behalf of our SNJB family, it gives me an immense pleasure to deliver a vote of thanks for this one wonderful event of this guest lecture series. I would like to thank our guest who honored this lecture with his wisdom and his knowledge. I would like to thank our beloved principal, Dr. Sri Upasani, sir, for his wonderful guidance, for his motivation and his kind words. I would like to thank our staff members, our colleagues, our participants, your volunteers, all people who have supported this event. Last but not the least, I would like to thank the technical team who assisted us for the organizing of this wonderful event. Thank you. Thank you so much.
Thank you,
Dr.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you, one and all.
Thank you, one and all.
All of us will be organizing another series. We will come up with the flyer of series. Stay tuned. Stay healthy. Stay happy.
Thank you, sir. Thank you.
Bye.
Thank you, sir.